what's going to happen when you start something. I don't know. I didn't think of the future as being something like this, but here we are, and I couldn't be happier. This organization is exploding at a never-increasing rate. So 2 years ago, we combined all the awards and created this celebration just to match this growing size and impact, and to hold it here at the beautiful Signature Theater Center, whose executive director is a league member, Erica Mallon. And tonight, the Signature family is represented here by Christine Millen from the executive board. Welcome, Christine. It isn't very often that a person like me gets to be on the stage with all these people. And maybe if I had a piano player, I could audition for some of them right now. But the director, Anne Bogart, told me to keep it moving, so I'll spare you my audition. But it's wonderful to be here with all of them, for whom I have very so much respect. And of course, in the audience tonight as well, past honorees, past presidents, offices, board officers, and board members, and memberships. The membership of the league is a wealth of fabulous women, and now I am delighted to introduce you to the two new presidents who have worked so hard this season to keep the league wheels turning, the current co-presidents, Pamela Hunt and Carmel Owen.
For just being here.
As Estelle said, the league is continuing to expand our reach and impact the conversation about theater today, especially the conversation about the representation of women in the theater.
In the past year, we released an update of our much-discussed report on the hiring of women off-Broadway. This report has been widely disseminated and reported on in newspapers, magazines, and all over the web.
Also this year, as part of our mission as advocates for women in theater, we inaugurated the League of Professional Theater Women Seal of Approval in two flavors, regular and gold.
We're delighted to announce the 2016 recipients of the seal, off-Broadway theaters in which 50% of playwrights and or 50% of directors hired in the most recent season were women. To the following: Lincoln Center Theater, Manhattan Theater Club, MCC Theater, The Flea Theater, The New Group, Rattlestick Playwrights Theater, Roundabout Theater Company, and Signature Theater Company.
And of the Gold Seal. Which is awarded to off-Broadway theaters in which 50% of playwrights or 50% of directors or both hired in the last five seasons were women. This award has gone to the Ensemble Studio Theater, Playwrights Horizons, Soho Rep, and the Labyrinth Theater Company. Congratulations to all.
Feel free to post or tweet or otherwise do what you do about the fabulous folk up here, the gorgeous flowers from Starbright Floral Design. Anything about our celebration tonight, but do turn the volume down. No ringing, please.
We are very grateful for the support of the Betty R. and Ralph Sheffer Foundation, Edith Meiser Foundation, Schwab Charitable Fund, Dorothy Strelson Foundation, and the Woolman Fund for making what we do possible. This year, we want to particularly thank the New York Women's Foundation for investing in our strategic planning and our future.
Each of the awards we present tonight has a glorious history and honors extraordinary theatrical accomplishments. You'll hear a little bit about each award when it is presented, and you can read more in your journals.
Our awards committee, led by Joan Firestone and Sheila Ray, and our Lucille Lortel Award Awards Committee, Helen by Kara Weichel and Kelly Ling Harrison, have done a tremendous job. Each of the 2016 recipients, as you'll soon see, truly exemplifies the spirit and values of her award. And the presenters are a pretty amazing array of talent and accomplishments as well.
Including our esteemed host, longtime lead member and luminary among theater artists, Estelle Parsons.
Take it away.
Thank you, Pam. Thank you, Carmel. Changing my major. Does that ring a bell? Yes, from this year's Lee Reynolds Award recipients, a number from their new musical. Here we have Lauren Patton, who will be accompanied by Chris Fenwick at the piano.
What happened last night? Are you really here? Joan, 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 Joan. Hi, Joan! Don't wake up, Joan. Oh my God, last night. Oh my God. Oh my God, oh my God, oh my God, last night. I got so excited, I was too enthusiastic. Thank you for not laughing, but you laughed a little bit. At one point when I was touching you, you said I might lose consciousness. But you said it was adorable, and I just meant to trust. But you don't think I'm an idiot or some kind of an animal. I never lost control to overwhelming lust. But I must say that I'm changing my major to Joan. I'll take out of the mentally huge high interest loan.
go, all art aspires to music. The Lee Reynolds Award remembers producer Lee Reynolds by recognizing women whose work in the theater unlocks its possibilities for social, cultural, and or political change. And to present the Lee Reynolds Award, currently represented on Broadway by his direction of Fun Home, Sam Gold.
Opportunity to think a lot about working with Lisa and Jeanine. And I took the opportunity to do a thing that I think a lot of people do sort of late night at home at their computer, which is I typed Lisa and Jeanine's name into the search engine in my email and then just went all the way back to the very beginning and sort of sifted through like 10 years of a lot of stuff. Actually, the very first email on the list is an email from a woman that I had gone on one date with who wrote, "It was really great to go on this date with you. In order to get to know me a little bit more, I'm going to send you a play that I wrote for my professor, Lisa Kron. It's an autobiographical performance in which I star as myself and in which deals with my complicated relationship with my ex-boyfriend and my mother." A lot after a first date. But I think the theme is that Lisa is always really pushing everybody to do very big, honest, raw things and put themselves out there. And anyway, over the 10 years of the correspondence, you know, there's also my marriage announcement to Lisa, to that woman, and our two children. All sorts of things. But I also started opening up old drafts of Fun Home, which there are a lot of. The first draft, they sent me the draft that they realized, the first draft they sent was actually a really old draft, and they've done a lot of work since then, and would you mind throwing that draft out and reading this draft? And the drafts we talked about, to our first reading, to then going to White Oak, going to Sundance, us doing a workshop, and many, 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 many drafts over the course of the lab at the Public Theater, to the first productions, changes made on Broadway, and I sort of like had them all open. You know, if you like open 2,000 word documents, you sort of like see them all like a stack. And I thought, if I took all of those documents, which kind of fill a library in either of their hometowns, that would be like this. I like to give it to everyone who's about to write a musical and say, this is, you know, this is the chaos and the bravery and the originality that you should approach this with. Or, you know, if you want to make something original and historic, you know, look at what it takes. And I also wanted to, this never gets said, so I don't know, publicly, I just want to list this. These are some of my favorite songs that were cut from Fun Home. Things Go Glimmering, Heat and Light, Draw, The Lord Moves, and there's a litany of opening numbers here. Life in Boxes, which at that time contained the lyric, "In real life there is no plot or arc, just patterned shapes made of light and dark." That's something that, you know, Lisa just threw out. It's Only Paper and Pen, Antigone in Vermont, 4:30 in the morning. I'm still just reading opening numbers. There's also a song that was done in a full production, recorded on a cast album, and then dumped, called Al for Short. Among many, many other things, which is just to say, looking back, it's an amazing thing to look back, because what they did, I mean, it was a mess for a really long time, and Lisa would send me a new draft of the preface that would say, like, sorry, this is a little disjointed, or this is really different than the last draft I sent you. I hope it makes sense, or something like that. And there was a lot of that as I went through all the old stuff. And to think that I think what Lisa and Jeanine did that is very brave and a very real kind of artistic practice, is that they were willing to live in this mess, in this chaos, and to be okay with that, and to be brave about that. And they had a kind of inner strength to face that abyss and to keep throwing out material, even if it was good, because they were searching for something very ambitious. And they had so much respect for the material and respect for themselves and I keep going back to the idea of like giving everybody all those drafts and seeing so that I could say, you know, do you have the kind of bravery that those two had to make it through the process? The other thing I wanted to say is, you know, looking back over the years, that it's kind of amazing that in the pressure cooker of having to write that, to have the burden of the book, the burden of each other, the burden of producers and a date, an opening night date and all that, and the way that can get very intense, they also somehow were always the kindest, most collaborative, most patient, most available, most empathic collaborators I ever worked with, which is something I wanted to say publicly. So I'm very happy to have the chance to come up here. You know, we all went through so much over those years, and you can see, you know, looking back over the emails, you sort of see the way we shared not just the show, but our lives with each other, and that's very important. And the way they gave of themselves to me personally, and to the work, is sort of the same thing. They gave all of themselves very bravely, and I'm very happy to have the chance to say that in front of you guys and to Lisa, who now has to come up on stage. Over to me.
And I'm here representing myself and Jeanine. We're both so pleased and honored to get this award. I really feel like I've just been, just had a trip back through the past 7 years, so I'm a little, maybe I have a little PTSD right now, actually. I was just thinking when Sam was saying that, when we did our first workshop, I said to Sam, do you want me to, I probably have a lot of, as the actors are working, I probably have a lot of notes. I can hold them, you know, and you can give me a time when you want to hit them. He said, no, just as we go along. And I was like, are you sure? And he was like, yeah, no, totally. And I would say it was maybe 2 hours in. He was like, okay, all right. He was like, every line after you said, I was like, yeah, not like that. You need to be like this. You need to calm yourself down. But anyway, he's really, well, everything he said back at him. I could say more, except I'm the one getting the award, so. incredible process, of course. I wanted to say on behalf of myself and Jeanine how much it means to get this award. And I think, you know, the thing that gets said a lot about Fun Home is that it was the first musical written by an all-woman team of composers to get the Tonys. And that's interesting, and it's helpful in some ways, and whatever. But the fact is, Jeanine and I both know that we come from a legacy of women theater makers who have always been here. And I think the more I hear that first, the more resistance I have to it, because there's a way that we keep going back to the beginning somehow. And so part of what I think is so meaningful to both of us about getting this award is receiving it with this group of people, all of them. I mean, I'm looking at Micki Grant, and you'll hear more about her when she wins her award, but you know, you you look back and you see that there have always been incredible women in every part of the theater, and it's, you know, I'm just gonna really briefly read you a thing that I wrote about when I was in college, and I didn't know about any of those women. And what happened was I came to New York and found the Women's Project, actually. And I remember sitting in that office and reading these plays. But I'm gonna write to you, read you just a short thing that I wrote about what happened to me when I was in college. I was a senior in college, sitting on the edge of my dorm room bed in the middle of the day, paralyzed by the sudden realization that the extraordinary world I had just begun to discover, the world of theater, was closed to me. During the preceding 3.5 years, I had honed my talents, playing an array of bit parts as old women, neighbor ladies, and the occasional animal. I had been told by the head of the theater department that he couldn't use me in bigger roles because, in his indelible words, "You just don't convey any sexuality on stage." I was told I was a character actress, which I later decided was actually a code word for lesbian. But this was my senior spring, and I had paid my dues, and the show was William Inge's Picnic, and the lead role was Rosemary, an old maid, which, come on, that's a lead role for a lesbian. But that part went to a skinny sophomore, and I was given the part of Mrs. Potts, the elderly neighbor lady. I had no actual scenes, just crosses where I would utter quick but pivotal phrases like, "I baked a Lady Baltimore cake." And at the end of the play, all the women sit in the yard, devastated because the young man who had wandered into the town and had given them reason to live had wandered off again. And then I had my big speech. He walked through the door and suddenly everything was different. Everything he did reminded me there was a man in the house and it seemed good. And that reminded me I'm a woman and that seemed good too. And on this day, it suddenly occurred to me that this speech summed up everything I might be given to do in the theater. I would never play a character who grapples with work or love or friendship or politics or religion or sex or power. My job would be to reflect upon the actions and importance of the male characters in plays that seemed not to even notice that the elevation of one type of character seemed to hinge on the diminishment of whole classes of others. Theater was the most compelling, powerful thing I could imagine, but it was becoming clear to me that this power to affect, to transform, was in someone else's hands, and the best I could ever hope for was to catch a ride on someone else's view of the world. I came to New York, I came to the Women's Project and read all those plays, I came to the East Village and saw the Split Bridges Company, which changed my life. I wrote here that the Split Bridges Company taught me the most important lesson I had ever learned about theater. It's a lesson that I see reflected in these women here and in all of the women who I work with, who Jeanine works with, who make theater and who've always made theater. We who make theater may be shut out of institutions, but we work in an art form that gives us total, unfettered, imaginative power to recreate the world on our own terms. I'm very grateful to be part of this legacy, and I'm very grateful, and I know Jeanine is too, to be honored tonight. Thank you so much.
The Ruth Morley Design Award. Ruth Morley died much too soon. She was an extraordinary designer. She did Tootsie. She created the Annie Hall look. And every time I was in a play or directing a play or whatever, I would call Ruth first and she would always be there. She wasn't a huge award winner. And we all used to say she wasn't a huge award winner, because people looked like they were wearing their own clothes. They didn't look like they were wearing costumes. I think you know what I mean. Since we're all in the theater, right? She has two wonderful daughters, and I hope to see when this program is over. It's the Ruth Morley Design Award given to not just costume design, but other designers as well. And to present the Morley Design Award, the director of the current Broadway revival of The Color Purple, as well as the new artistic director of Classic Stage Company, and so many other things we won't even talk about at Read Your Program. This is John Doyle.
In 2008, I was looking for a lighting designer for a production of Steve Sondheim's Roadshow at the Public Theatre. Ruth Sternberg, head of production down there, wanted me to meet a couple of her recommendations. And one of Ruth's splendid suggestions was Jane Cox. Now, I've been making theatre for over 40 years, and I've worked with a rich variety of talented artists. I've worked with some of the greatest living set designers and costume designers, but I'm ashamed to say that until 2008, I'd never worked with a female lighting designer. Now, I don't think there were many in the UK, and the irony is that I had to come to the US to find one, from my own side of the ocean. I absolutely knew in that small interview room at the Public that I had found somebody with whom I could share all that I enjoy in collaboration. Humility, humor, honesty, and while sharing a common belief in the importance of theater as a form that can create change, recognizing that we are all only small cogs in the wheel. We both come from backgrounds where our Celtic grandmothers would have taken no nonsense and would have quickly put us in our place should we overstep the mark or get too big for our boots. Putting on a new show is never easy. Putting on a new Sondheim, especially a troubled one, in New York City, is a form of madness. Very quickly, I realized that I had a light mind in the madness. Jane has a wonderful eye, a great sense of style, and good taste. Perhaps most importantly, she thinks deeply and sees theater as part of our contemporary experience. This depth influences the way she operates, primarily because she listens. The field she has been exploring, lighting design, is much, much more than illumination. It's art. It helps us to feel. It needs deep emotional and intellectual vision to make it work. Being in the room together for the making of Roadshow at the Public, Caucasian Chalk Circle at ACT, The Three Sisters and Merrily We Roll Along at Cincinnati, Wings at Second Stage, Lucia de Lammermoor at the Sydney Opera House, 10 Cents to Dance at Williamstown, Passion and Allegro at Classic Stage, and most recently, The Color Purple on Broadway. I have always treasured the laughter of sitting by Jane in a dark, tired auditorium, mutually finding a way of making the story live. Poor Jane. She's even had to save my bacon by lighting sets that I also designed. So thanks, Jane, for making Passion and The Color Purple so classy. So often in the theater, ego overwhelms craft. This is never the case with Jane. She puts the story first and is totally honest in all that she does. A few years ago, Jane asked me to meet with Stacey Wolfe, a colleague of hers at Princeton University. This led to my joining the faculty and so becoming a colleague of Jane's on another level. We often teach on the same days and have shared many dreary New Jersey transit journeys full of fun and laughter. Now, a new era begins. Jane has become director of the theater program at Princeton, and so I'd better start behaving myself. Those students are so lucky. They have a working artist and a great human being who will help them find love in an art form that has given us all so much. Jane understands better than most the place and purpose of theatre today. Nobody could be better for those students than Jane Cox. She will care, she will challenge, she will be rigorous, and she will be loved. As I begin my tenure as Artistic Director of CSC, I'm excited about further collaborations with Jane, bringing together art and education. Two Europeans lucky enough to make a small mark on the American theatre. So much has happened in these few years, Jane. You have your lovely family, Evan and Beckett. You've been so supportive to Rob and I during some difficult personal times, and we share many wonderful friendships. I'm so happy that you're being honored this evening, and I am humbled that I was asked to speak in tribute of you. We share a time when we have together made an important story on Broadway, a story that celebrates women in their strength and in their glory. Who would ever have thought that two Celtic dreamers would have been some part of telling this great female African-American tale? Thank you, Jane, for all you give. Thank you, Ruth Sternberg, for your very astute introduction. And thank you, League of Professional Theatre Women, for honoring my pal, Jane Cox.
The stories we told about women were steeped in things that I didn't understand or didn't care to understand, and often were told in whispers. Stories about boys and men filled the pages of the books we read in school, the lyrics of the songs we listened to on the weekends, and male words were spoken out loud in the plays and the films we watched. Gender was totally pervasive. I'm probably the only person in my class from secondary school whose future career could have made use of technical drawing, but I had to take home economics instead. On the other hand, if anyone at school had been particularly concerned about my making a living instead of making babies, I probably wouldn't have ended up in the theater. I had an unpressured childhood, and a lot of time was spent staring at clouds in an ever-changing Irish landscape of light. Because of my childhood, I was drawn to imaginary landscapes. And because of my childhood, I didn't notice when I started my career in America 20 years ago that I was almost exclusively working on stories about men, with men, in institutions run by men. Thank goodness, at some point in my 30s, my work life started to fill up with these extraordinary women, so much so that I had to look up and start paying attention. Since then, I've become the feminist my mother wanted me to be. And I look back in horror at the number of women I looked past to find the brilliant man in the room in my 20s and early 30s. It's been so exciting, actually, and thrilling to realize over the last 10 years that there are twice as many wonderful, brilliant, opinionated, creative, fabulous people on the planet than I thought when I was 13. So I'd like to take this opportunity to do a roll call of a small handful of the extraordinary women who've made my journey in the American theater so far so wonderful. Penny Remsen, lighting teacher at UMass Amherst, who told myself and Justin Townsend and Ben Stanton that we should be lighting designers when we didn't even know what that was. Testament to the power of brilliant teachers. Incredible designers have had the fortune to explore theater with, including but not limited to Mimi Lien, Christine Jones, Beverly Emmons, Rachel Houck, S. Devlin, Laura Jelnick, Deb Dryden, Anya Klepikoff, Chris Stone, Wendell Harrington, Kelly Hansen. A amazing young women who've inspired me and supported me, young designers who've supported me in their roles as my associate, Tess Jennings, Cecilia Durbin, Alex Mannix, Vic Brennan, Isabella Bird, Portia McGovern. Brilliant female writers, directors, and other women of the theater who've inspired me and hired me, including Anne Washburn, Annie Baker, Bash Duran, Lisa Loomer, Sarah Rule, Susan R. Parks, Tia Corthron, Monica Bill Barnes, Lindsay Turner, Pam McKinnon, Annie Ryan, Laurie Woolery, Carol Fishman, Lisa Peterson, Tina Landau, Liesl Tommy, Maria Stryer, Joanna Settle, Amanda Denner, Denise Thoron, Vivian Banish, Marcella Lorca, Denise Cooper, and many, 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 many others. The brilliant women in many professions and these incredible women here at the League who have fought for the proper recognition of women in the theater, in the workplace and in the theater, whose tireless work I'm clearly the beneficiary of. Finally, though, I do need to circle back to two men in the room to say thank you, both of them whom hate having their attention called to them. John Doyle, who you've learned that I met 8 years ago in an interview set up by a very smart woman, who showed me how to access my own creativity, really, to trust my own judgment, and who has really led me to where I am as an artist. Thank you. And that very same year, almost the same month, I think, 8 years ago, I had the unbelievable good fortune of finding a kind and brilliant partner, Evan Alexander, sitting in the front row, a man who has helped me to understand myself, who's taught me to laugh at myself, and who always understood that my career needed as much nurturing as his did before and after we had a child together. A man who is, as all theater spouses are, one of the true heroes of the theater business. A person for whom every additional preview represents an evening alone at home with a small child. May that same small child, our four-year-old daughter Beckett, grow up into a world where the stories we tell represent the stories of 51% of the planet.
Example of what meritorious service is. Elsa Rael started or had down at the public festival for women, by women, and at the time I was doing a lot of Dario Fo feminist plays, one of which was a one person small Italian village, Medea. And Elsa asked me would I like to do it in the festival. Which I did, and the response of that audience was so astonishingly different from the response of a regular two or four or six or eight or however many sexes there are today. But so completely different. It was an experience that just chokes me up even now. I didn't really expect to get choked up even though I am an actress. But it was an experience never to be forgotten by me, and I hope for everybody who was in that audience where the women could truly enjoy Medea and her life and my performance. So tonight, Elsa Rael is about to get this special award for meritorious service, and it will be presented by the League's Vice President of Programming. In fact, she designed this whole event tonight and co-produced it. Writer-director Shellen Lubin.
Tonight, so I want to tell you another story. Before the League of Professional Theater Women existed, Elsa Rael, on her own, created this one-day event at the 53rd Street Y, a whole day of panels And then in the evening there were performances and brought together people from different aspects of the theater industry, all women discussing and illuminating ideas of how to support each other in this business. We're talking around 1980. And at that event, Julia Miles and Margot Lewitton were up on the stage together, and they were talking on the stage in front of the audience and were discussing how men network and how most networking is done in bathrooms and on golf courses. And they said they needed to get together the important women in theater so that women in theater could network the way men did. That was before even that meeting Estelle was talking about at the American Plex. So that's how long ago Elsa was working on this stuff and these issues. That Festival at the Public that Estelle mentioned, that was a few years later, and this will tell you another thing about Elsa. When Elsa Rael won a CAPS grant in playwriting, she took that money and turned around and created this festival, gave it all away as prize money, got Joe Papp to produce this three-day event of plays at the Public Theater, all featuring major roles for women over the age of 50. She is, and the kind of person she has always been, a generosity you cannot believe and cannot be matched. The night I met her, she offered me her country home for 2 months so I could finish writing the musical that I had been struggling to finish. The night I met her, I am not kidding. That's how we became friends. I was up in her house all summer. I was not a member of the League in its early years, but still, Elsa enlisted me to participate with her whenever possible, including writing a song together that Micki Grant sang in an early event, and writing together for Lucille Lortel's 90th birthday at Sardi's that the League made a party for her, an entire mini musical that the two of us wrote together that was started by Mimi Turk, who was out there tonight. And when the League decided over 20 years ago to bring together all the unions and guilds in our industry, along with other women's organizations in the arts and media, to become a coalition of organizations working for the voice and vision of women in the arts and in media, she brought me along to that too. And in fact, at one point, we were together co-presidents of that coalition about 15 years ago, and I am now co-president with Leslie Shreve, who is sitting there next to her. Although Elsa is always doing her own writing and creating of plays and musicals and festivals and children's books and now a novel, she is always supporting other women, reaching out her generous heart and hand to help others. So many of the people here tonight have a story about how she has supported them. Just ask. How she has encouraged them, advised them, cared for them. She has been on the board of the League a number of times, served on the awards committee, the international committee, and for a number of years, she was the sunshine committee all by herself. But she can do that, she can be sunshine all by herself. She holds the writing group of the League in her apartment. The discipline circles all started in her apartment. Whenever you need to have a meeting midtown, if she's there, she'll offer her apartment and she'll make you lunch or dinner, I gotta say. And on the work front, I'm pleased to say that we are almost done writing a musical based on her award-winning children's book, When Zeta Danced on Eldridge Street, book by Elsa, lyrics by me, music by Matthew Gandolfo. This woman never stops. She never stops creating, she never stops doing, she never stops caring. With all my heart, I am so pleased to present the LPTW Special Award for Meritorious Service to one of my dearest friends for over 35 years. There is no one who has been more devoted to this organization and to all women in theater, Elsa Rael.
members that I sponsored. Many of you are here tonight. And especially one very special group, my writing group, and some of you are here tonight. I can't tell you how that group gets together once a month. Had a rough year this year. I fell and was hospitalized for 3 months. So we haven't met as frequently as we should, but we will be getting together again very shortly. Thank you all for honoring me so generously, so sweetly, so. Very, very kindly. I love you all. I love this group. And Shellen, incidentally, is now running. She's now president of the coalition. And she brought it back alive. And let me tell you, this is some woman. She is some friend. I adore her. I adore you all.
Is about how we create social structures and how we can get better at it. And one of the things when we go to a play, we see two plays at the same time. We see that edifice, but we also see the story. This is not on the executive brain part where you're watching a story, but on a deeper, more atavistic level, you're actually experiencing how a group of people are getting along on the stage. I think that what Lear has done in terms of making communities visible is extraordinary and unprecedented in many ways, and she's doing it in ways where she's reinventing the form. And not only with her work with large community groups, but also with her group that every community she works with of artists, and that's amazing. Another second fact is about enthusiasm. And we all in this room know that the most horrible thing to fake is enthusiasm. You know how horrible it feels? And yet enthusiasm is one of the major ingredients to actually making work that has presence. And it turns out that enthusiasm etymologically comes from the Greek entheo, to be filled with God. And it is our obligation as theater people to actually to cultivate enthusiasm, a love of the art form. And I would say that Lear de Bessonet expresses enthusiasm in such a tremendous way, and that it's contagious. And it's a contagious enthusiasm which is good for the field and good for the world and rather extraordinary. Now, this is all fine and good, this ability to animate communities, this enthusiasm, but the other thing that Lear de Bessonet brings is her artistry. And without that, and it's not just technique, it's, what is that, the T word we can't talk about called taste. Yeah. It's not really talent, you think the T word is talent, but taste, aesthetics, oh, here I am, I am an old professor, I'm always like talking about etymology, but aesthetics actually means sensation. You know, the opposite of aesthetic is anesthetic, which we get put under in various moments. The best theater has not, you know, I used to think of aesthetics as some highfalutin idea of compositional integrity, but it actually just means sensation. And the artistry that Lear brings to her work and to her relationships with people, which is the foundation of our field, is highly aesthetic and artistic. And I just want to, before I bring her up, I want to say how thrilled I am that this award is named the Josephine Abady Award. And for those who remember Josie Abady, who died far too early, and she was an extraordinary force. I was thinking of her tonight, and I thought, I would call her the Wendy Wasserstein of directors. For those who know her, she had that similar quality of enthusiasm. And I'm so happy, and since our job in the theater is to remember, or to remember, here I go again, put things back together again, to take the members and put them back. In honor of Josie Abady and Lear never, I asked Lear if she knew Josie, and Lear's too young. Josie died much too young, but I'm so happy, and I hope you can remember her as part of the acceptance. So without further delay, Lear de Bessonet.
Actually owe my entire career to Anne Bogart. She's tried to downplay this fact when I've brought it up before, but the reality is that I moved here to New York from Louisiana when I was 21 years old because Anne Bogart gave me a chance and made me her assistant director, and she changed my life forever, and I will thank her every chance I get for that. So, thank you. Also, in the conversation in which we established that I was going to become her assistant director, she did talk about the root of the word ecstasy, ecstasis, which is to stand outside of oneself. So, it's not a totally new thing. But, you know, I came here today straight from the Bronx, where we were doing auditions for the fourth Public Works show that's happening this summer. So we've now, the past 3 years, we have done these 200-person spectaculars in the park. You saw a couple of pictures of them. bringing together New Yorkers from all over the city. This summer will be the first time that I'm not directing. Kwame Kwayarma is directing 12th Night. So the first year we did The Tempest, the second year we did Winter's Tale, then The Odyssey, and now 12th Night. And actually, because I'm in the process of both sort of equipping Kwame to go into this room with 200 people and direct this show, and also Public Works is sort of branching out in other ways as well. We have branches that are starting in Seattle at Seattle Rep, and in Dallas at Dallas Theater Center. So it's sort of becoming this this national movement of civic pageantry. And in the process of doing that, I've had a lot of opportunity to think about, well, first of all, what that form is, but even more broadly, what theater is and why it matters. And I feel like the process of working with people, citizens who are having their first ever encounter with the theater, having that experience is the greatest masterclass of all, because it teaches me what, in the most elemental form, what is happening when we gather in the theater. And I think that the thing that has become clearest to me is that it is a fundamentally humanizing impulse behind the theater. And at these auditions, well, today and yesterday, we had auditions with our veterans organization, Military Resilience Project, and I got to see 19 veterans and their families come and audition, and again, have their first ever experience in the theater. And the material that people prepare for these auditions is so unexpected and amazing. We had one gentleman performed a monologue from Casablanca. He played both roles. We had a father and his 11-year-old son did a reading from Beauty and the Beast. They read all the parts. The little boy was Mrs. Potts, and he was the clock, and they did all of this stuff. We had a couple of incredibly angry poems that were, you know, including the word motherfucker like more times than I thought could possibly happen in a poem. But that's all part of like a public works audition. And I think that the invitation, that the fact that actually there's room for all of that in the theater, there's room for all of those people. And hopefully you'll get to see them on stage this summer at the Delacorte. You can wonder who wrote the poem and who did the Beauty and the Beast stuff. But being in those rooms and witnessing people overcome their fear, overcome all of the sense of what divides us from one another, to stand up and say they want to be part of this unifying thing, they want to tell a story together with other people, for other people. It excites me enormously, and I feel like in a world in which empathy is in such short supply, and in which there's so much difficulty finding ways to fully see, recognize the humanity of people who have different presumptions about the world, I just feel very honored to be carrying the banner of theater high, the humanizing banner of theater. So I love this work, I love being a woman doing this work, and I'm very grateful for this recognition. Thank you so much.
And comes with a grant toward the recipient's work. Our Lucille Lortel Committee views the work of many emerging women artists throughout the year to determine the recipient. To present this year's Lortel Award winner, renowned playwright Tina Howe. Woo!
Funny and clever, because I'm a writer and I don't know how to do that. So I'd have to read a little something that I poured myself into it, but I can't do what these other extraordinary women have done. So bear with me. I must begin by congratulating the League of Professional Theatre Women for giving the Lucille Lortel Award to Ari Laura Kreith. I think that's what Who is this dainty, sylph-like maiden who looks like a poet that writes verse plays, or a lighting designer who eschews electricity in favor of candlelight, or perhaps a hidden performer wielding an arsenal of shadow puppets, both human and divine? And what does that number of her theater, 167, stand for? Part of its street address? The number of seats in the house, or the weight of her chairman of the board? None of the above. It's the number of languages spoken in Jackson Heights, where the theater is located. So what does Ari do as artistic director in this Tower of Babel? She wrangles large numbers of writers and actors to create their own work. What kind of numbers am I talking about? Her Jackson Heights trilogy encompassed three full-length plays collaboratively written by 18 playwrights featuring 37 actors playing 93 roles speaking 14 languages. Who does that? As playwrights, actors, designers, and directors, it's all most of us can do to get one show up and running. Even as the brilliant and sturdy professional theater women we are. But working with 18 playwrights in one room, 37 actors playing 93 roles in 14 languages, why? It sounds like an invitation to the psych ward. But look at this shape-shifting young woman. She's eerily serene. Perhaps her work is just an illusion created with smoke and mirrors. She wasn't born Ari, after all, but named herself after a lovely watercolor she'd seen hanging in the lobby of a theater titled Ari at the Beach. Ari had an extraordinary childhood as the daughter of refugee scientists growing up in 37 countries. So the din of many languages was familiar to her, as were the tensions that rise when different cultures collide. Guess what she wanted to be when she went to Yale as an undergraduate? A diplomat. So she could acquire the tools of negotiation and compromise on the highest level. But having acted in a semi-professional production of a Shakespeare play at the age of 6, she also knew about the transformative power of theater. So she went to get an MFA in acting at the University of California at Davis. But as a performer, she became acutely aware of the challenges her fellow actors faced and realized she wanted to be a director. Why? Because she's interested in the big picture, not just the production of a play here and there, but exploring the lives and heartaches of entire communities with the artists who make them up. Ari Laura Kreith is a one-woman band. Her accomplishments are all the more astonishing in this downsizing age of ours, when we're, as teachers certainly, we're encouraged to tell our students to put a play in one set with a minimum of 4 actors. I saw part of her Jackson Heights trilogy, and it was one of the most buoyant theatrical experiences I've ever had. All of those actors, all of those language, all that movement as a cast of 25 morphed into so many different characters on different sides of the law, trying to disappear or be seen, struggling to be heard or loved, succeeding and failing, but never giving up. Creating the whole Jackson Heights trilogy with Ari at the helm, that mysterious girl in the watercolor, Ari at the beach, guiding them. Leave it to a dainty, soft-spoken woman to smash the conventional wisdom of how to make theater, and leave it to the lead of professional theater women to honor her. Brava all around. Welcome, Ari Laura Kreith.
Very special to have Tina introduce me tonight because the very first thing I ever directed was a scene from one of her plays. I don't even know how this happened because at the time I was determined not to be a director. But somehow I found myself in a directing class, and somehow I was the only woman in that directing class. And I chose to direct the Elizabeth Barrow cult scene from The Art of Dining. You know, the one where she speaks her truth in an extremely awkward way, sabotages her dinner date, but makes all of us fall in love with her. It's also a scene about eating disorders, which was something no one was talking about at the time. And somewhere in the midst of rehearsal, I realized a director gets to choose what we talk about. And that realization was exciting and scary. And presenting the scene in a room full of men who were directing Williams and O'Neill and saying, this is the story I'm interested in telling and here's why it matters. That was huge for me. Of course, I still didn't want to be a director. I was scared of being responsible for other people. It's a bit how funny how things have turned out, jumping from that early fear to falling in love with plays when they're just embryonic ideas and then bringing 37 people into a room and saying something's gonna happen. But there are two things that made me take that leap. A desire to tell stories that weren't being heard and a love of actors. Because somewhere in grad school, I started reading plays that just needed to happen. And I started watching my classmates and realizing they were capable of going deeper in the work that they were doing. And I wanted to be a catalyst for that, so I directed one play. And then another. But even when I began to embrace my identity as a director, I was not going to be a female director. I even changed my name, partly because I wanted our audiences just to engage with the story, and partly because I grew up in 37 countries, and often the stories that interested me weren't the stories people expected a little blonde girl from California to tell. We talk often about the coincidences that allow us to have one life or another, but in theater we feel that. We inhabit another person's skin, feel the ways their lives could so easily have been our own. And in so doing, we learn to live in a bigger world. And we realize that we're all responsible for one another, not just in the rehearsal room, but in life. We're responsible for the things that come out of our mouths, for the fact that people are starving or being killed in this country or in others, for the environmental crises we are facing. So many things. Being responsible for a play is actually pretty small when you think of it. But it's also huge, because being responsible for a play means you get to choose what people talk about. We get to choose the stories we tell and who we invite into the room to tell those stories with us. We get to invite one another out of our discrete understanding of the world and into a malleable universe of shared experience. Over the past few years, I've come to embrace the ways I'm a female director. My friend and collaborator, Jenny Lynn Bader, often says I birth plays. Members of the Theater 167 company created the hashtag 167family to reflect their support of one another's work. And I'm a mother, which reminds me daily that the world we create through our work is not just for ourselves, but for the future. And I also realize that as a director, my responsibility is just to begin the conversation, to ask the questions, to launch the process, and then to listen to all the other voices in the room. And the magic of what we do at Theater 167 is that we get to have conversations we hope can happen in the world at large. We get to build a world on stage that challenges us to transform our offstage one and that reflects our collective hopes and dreams for what's possible. Tina recently asked me about the number of languages spoken on stage at Theater 167, and in my head I heard three phrases. Didi Kamanacho, that's Bengali, from 167 tongues. It means sister or brother, how are you doing? Tessa Amutam, Amharic from Morning Sun, hope is not dead. Zikomo Kwandiri, Chichewa from Pereira, thank you very much. And together they became like a little song, a mini play. Didi Kamanacho, Tessa Amutam, Zikomo Kwandiri. It's what we do as artists. We ask, how are you, my sister, my brother? What is your truth in this world? We say, hope is not dead. If we can tell these stories, we can change our world. And we say thank you. Thank you for your bravery in the telling and the hearing of these stories with us. And so, Sikomu, danke, toda rabba, gracias, xie xie. and thank you in all the languages I don't know yet.
But within minutes of meeting her, I felt as if we were lifelong friends because I knew her work. I think she and her writing have that effect on most everyone she meets. She has won so many Lifetime Achievement Awards that she may well make you believe in reincarnation. She has been honored so many times as a playwright, a composer, a lyricist, an actor, a producer, and a director, but it's hard to figure out how she had time between acceptance speeches to create such a distinguished body of work. She is admired. She is loved. And if you know her the way I have come to, the elegant woman sitting there, the one with the delicate features and the beautiful smile, is respected throughout our industry and across our country because she is not afraid to fight full on. A woman, after seeing one of Micki's new shows in its pre-Broadway tryout, wrote her that Micki's words had drawn blood, but the incision was clean. Walter Kerr opined that Micki hits you hard, but she hits you fair. You'll think I'm making this up, but just last night she was at an event with Donald Trump. By the time Micki was through with him, he vowed to close down his Twitter account, immigrate to Mexico, and build a 20-foot soundproof wall around his mouth. And this comes to Tracy. Okay, I did make that up. But if the Donald really did find himself in a room with our honoree, I have no doubt who would leave bowed and defeated, shaking his head and muttering, "Don't bother me, I can't cope." Yes, she's a tiger, but that's not all. She's also a crocodile. What, you may ask, is a crocodile? Allow me to tell you. A crocodile is an individual who has won the Grammy, the Clio, the Irish Critics Circle Award, the Drama Desk Award, and the Obie. Add in her Tony nominations, her seemingly endless roster of other awards, honors, and honorary degrees, and whatever you might call her becomes totally remarkable and utterly unpronounceable. You may think I'm making this up, but she's had to move to larger apartments several times just to find enough mental space for all of her awards. Well, okay, I made that up too. But there's a metaphorical truth to it. Although not the kind of graceful, poetic metaphor our honoree would write, You've seen her long list of works and accomplishments in various media. All of these works, these masterful Broadway and off-Broadway shows, these extraordinary performances, came from the mind, pen, keyboard, and the heart of the same extraordinary person. Micki's accomplishments were all put into perspective for me as we were about to open Don't Bother Me, I Can't Cope at the York, where it blew the roof off our theater, I should say. New York Magazine wrote a laudatory assessment of the show and said that this was everyone's chance to catch this legendary musical, which ran for more than 2 years on Broadway, which was the first time an African-American woman had single-handedly written a Broadway musical. But New York Mag got it wrong. In 1971, Micki Grant was the first woman, period, to write an entire Broadway musical. That, all on its own, is a lifetime achievement. No, Micki Grant. Watch this, please.
Story? Is that what your papers want? A story? Listen, here's a story. Not much fun and not much glory. Low class, low down. The thing you never care to see until there is a showdown. Here it is. I'll make it snappy. Are you ready? Everybody happy?
If you could be as happy as Dick and I were, believe me, that kind of happiness is nothing to throw away for any reason under the sun. I know that tonight more deeply than I ever knew it.
I was a little shaken by what I just heard. Well, rape is a very difficult subject, but it has to be discussed.
I didn't know there were so many victims.
Unfortunately, there are, and all too often the crime goes unreported.
I know, they said that people are afraid or ashamed to go tell the police about it.
Yes. And it's sad when help is available, but the victims won't come forward.
And the fact that rape isn't just a street crime. Statistics on rape within a family. I just can't believe it. They gave me some things to read, and I'm going to study a little. And look, they gave us this poster that we should put up on the bulletin board on our floor.
Good. You know, I think those of us who work in healthcare should learn as much as we can about the subject. That way we'll be able to help patients who've experienced the trauma of rape.
Longevity runs in the family. I'm sure that's part of why we're still here.
We outlive the Ribby boys. We're getting the last word.
Yes. That's justice. That's one way to view. We are having our say. Giving our opinion. Lord, ain't it good to be an American?
I'll tell you a little secret. I'm starting to get optimistic.
Now I've got a guy and his name is Stewie. He's my guy and I love him truly. He's not good looking.
this could have happened.
The community center
favorite things to do was the dramatics. There was a dramatic class, which was led by the dramatic teacher, Susan Porchet. I actually went to class with one of her younger brothers, and his name was Bobby Porch. And the rest of the family. But Susan was very dramatic, and so she was Susan Porchet. And Susan Porchet taught this 8-year-old how to project and emote. And this 8-year-old was going, "Roll on, thou deep and dark ocean. Roll." Wasn't quite that deep, but I did get the rolls. And Susan taught her several poems, and she began to be a regular on the programs at her church. And some of you will understand that a lot of us, the starting gate for us was the church. And after a while, not only at her church, this youngster was being taken around by her mother to other churches. She'd been invited to special events to recite her poems. And pretty soon she decided, I can write them myself. And so then she became more of a personality, because people were saying, oh, this young king is writing her own poetry, and we should hear her. Well, thanks to Susan Porchet. And anyway, the church, well, the pastor of the church decided, and the church agreed, that this young member that must have these poems published. At the age of 13, she acquired her first copyright. And it consisted of a collection of 26 poems written between the ages of 8 and 12. And this sort of began her journey along the yellow brick road. Now, it's I must refer back to the time when Susan Porchet cast her as the spirit of spring in one of the projects, and she had to go around with a magic wand and bring the daffodils to life and the tulips to life and the roses. And anyway, she was in charge of bringing life to all the elements of spring. And these few minutes on stage, she was smitten. Well, now she knew words, and she knew that she could be on the stage with words. And the next thing, she would sit by. I'm just giving you different phases of this growing up, this young kid's life. On the piano stool beside her father, and he played by ear, and listened to him play and sing the blues, and when he got up, he'd try and play what he played. And then, when she began to take violin lessons and found out there were notes, everybody had to learn and read and understand that these were the sounds, it almost became impossible to play by ear. And because my sister played the piano, I took lessons, but I moved to the violin, and from there to the double bass. But it's important to understand that early influences can affect one's future for the rest of one's life.
and I was very fortunate that I had my parents who were very encouraging. An older sister who really later became my biggest cheerleader. She loved the theater. And fortunately, all my beginnings were encouragement. And especially my sixth grade teacher, Miss Minnie Rose, who announced to me very emphatically, "You are a poet." And she even wrote on my report card in big, huge letters, upright letters, that your daughter excels in writing poetry. I must also remember my high school band teachers and Peter Slatnick, who said he was going to teach this young girl to play as many instruments as possible. And learn to play scales on the trombone, on the trumpet, on the bassoon. And you notice that I have gone to the first person from the third person. I learned this. I must thank them because I became familiar with instruments. So that the words became so important, but it was the spoken word, the written word, and finally the sung word. And the best, when most of the reality happened in Chicago, but then the person known as Micki Grant moved to New York, and that met a very dynamic director, most of you will know of, if you had that better. But anyway, Vanette Carroll. formed a collaborative association, and that association, I think, changed the careers. I know it certainly altered my career, but I think it altered the careers for both of us. And there were also the soap opera casting directors, Mae Bolhauer and Ruth Levine, who not only thought outside the box, but they acted outside the box. Of course, I can't forget the great Woody King Jr., Jr. was in the vanguard of the women's movement. And I think he still is because he would hire women stage managers, women lighting directors, but he was just right there from the beginning, hiring women. I can't mention every one of them. If you remember, there was a time when people used to turn up their noses at commercials until Laurence Olivier decided to speak with Kodak. And then it was quite all right, but I must remember Roy Eaton, who was gave me my first opportunity to start writing commercials and performing on commercials. And anyway, there was, I must not leave out Rosetta Benoit too, who played my mother in the and the founder of the Moss Repertory Theater. It's impossible to mention everyone who's been so influential and helpful along the way as I traveled this yellow brick road. And the ironical thing is that it seems that the most resistance that I ever faced was not really because of my year-round tan, but more or less because of gender. And the case in point, there was a time when Andre Arnaud, many of you may know, was a French American, and Elliot Tiger,
wanted to do a musical using the music of Jacques Brel that had not been heard in the States at that time. And so when they first mentioned that, they came to me and they wanted me to do the English lyrics to Andre's translations, because Jacques Brel had a great social conscience. And when it was first mentioned to someone, I understand the first thing that the person said, but she's a woman. I wasn't sure whether that meant because Jacques Brel was a man, I shouldn't do the work, or a woman should not be involved in this project. But if you recall, my man's gone now. Who wrote that? My man's gone now. Anyway, women can write for men, just as men can write for women. It reminds me of this incident, but she's a woman. Let's just know why it's so important to have the lead. Because at some point, we came to realize, and I'm glad I was there on the ground floor, we came to realize that before we could ask others to appreciate us, we have to appreciate ourselves, celebrate ourselves, and thank goodness that all of this came about, the lead came about. I just want to say that because of that support, and despite the potholes and the detours along the way, along the Shellen Road, because of the community of women, not only the League, but the community that was formed at the beginning, before the League, because of that community, this kid from Chicago traveled along, managed to stay on that road until she got to this podium. And it's better to stick to the script, otherwise you talk too much. But I want to say from the bottom of my heart, I thank you so much, Lee, the professional theater woman, and I'm so proud to be a part of you.
Thanks for coming. We'll see you next year.